Hey everybody, it's Jeff Lafferty, and it's time for another ArtCast. Number 19. Oh, sorry. I'm just like completely having a hard time drawing this and filming because it's just kind of like at a different level. I'm doing this piece a little bit bigger like the ones I've been doing, and it's just, let's see. So it's like kind of way up here, real high. I'm just having a hard time. I probably should have just taped it to a board and so I could have slid it over the edge of my drawing table at the bottom, but I don't know. But let's see, so should I talk about, did I say it was episode 19? I know I'm bumping the camera too, I can feel myself hitting it, so hopefully it's not going to mess the video up, but it's kind of amazing, like 19 of these things have already been out. I was posting, I got on Pinterest like today, just because I thought I should probably start posting a few more places, and I had a Pinterest account for a while and I couldn't figure it out, but I was on Facebook and I saw Tanya's sister on there, you know, on the little update screen, and she was liking all this stuff on Pinterest, and I clicked on a couple of them and it was like a Mexican recipes for tacos and stuff like that, you know. And I've been on there looking around, and I don't know. It's one of those social media places that I don't quite get. No offense to the people who like it. And let's see. I have a hard time figuring out where his scalp is hitting here. But I joined up there, and I just threw some of my, couple of my drawings on there, and I wasn't going to put like all my stuff on or anything, but I just kind of wanted to get going with something, and so I thought I'd just throw my videos on there, and I thought, well, if I'm going to put my videos on, I should probably just put all the new video blog ones, in case anybody's wanting to kind of start listening from the beginning. God, it took me like, you know, 20 minutes, and about halfway through, I was like, jeez, this is like a ton of work. Why am I doing this, you know? But, I believe in sort of trying to, as far as marketing, I don't have marketing figured out, but I do believe in giving people what they want, kind of where they want it. So, you know, I think a lot of you guys that follow me kind of can see what I do, but you know, I post on my site and everything, but I don't just post on my site and call it good, because you know, nobody goes to my site. I mean, now there's a few people who do, but you know, in general, people aren't hitting my site, they're hitting Facebook and they're hitting YouTube and all that kind of stuff. So I try to repost, I try to basically make the same setup wherever I'm at, like on YouTube. If you ever notice, like in the links below each video, there's a link to an eBay auction if there's a piece on eBay. Or lately I've just had like my, I think I have my link to eBay, and I also have my link to, I gotta grab some tape on this piece of paper, is getting all unsticky. But there's like a link to, I think, Patreon, and then there's a link to just my eBay, kind of, in general. I don't have an eBay store anymore, but you know, just kind of the general, you know, profile on eBay or whatever. Just kind of comes up to a page of all my stuff. And like on Facebook, it's kind of the same thing. If I put a piece on there, it's usually a link to it on eBay or to my store. You know, it's like the same kind of whatever you want to call it, sales funnel or whatever you want to say. I mean, that sounds kind of bad. I never really look at it that way, but you know, you post your stuff and you put up links to where people can buy them so they can find it, and that's basically what I do everywhere that I'm at, whether I'm on YouTube or DeviantArt or wherever. So I just figured I probably should be on Pinterest, I guess. I'll give it a try for a while. If it doesn't work, I'll forget about it. But I don't really, you know, like a lot of these places, I just kind of repost what I'm putting up. Even Facebook's kind of like that. I really don't have time to talk to a ton of people. Alright. Just dropped one of my colored pencils into the trash and fell right to the bottom. All I have is just a bunch of little nubs. I think I was complaining about being out of black colored pencils when I was drawing like Cornelius and Zira, and that's like two pieces ago now. And now I'm really out, and I got kind of screwed up today. I actually got confused. I saw up there by the, you know, kitchen and stuff. It's usually where I kind of just drop whatever I come in with. And I saw there was a brush bag laying there from like the art store, one of those little bags they stick brushes in. And I was like, oh, there's my color pencils, because I had bought some a while ago, and then I couldn't find that stupid bag, and I couldn't find my new brush, and it was driving me crazy. And then I saw it sitting there, and I thought, oh great, I got a couple black color pencils in there, I don't need to go to the art store and get any more, because I knew I was getting super low. And darn it, it's like, I opened it up and there was no blacks in there. There was just a couple, just a couple blue ones, a Tuscan red, and then there was a couple other colors I'd just been buying randomly, kind of trying to work in a few more colors into my work. And I was like, no! So then I had to do the search like I've done the last few pieces, search my studio for every little nub of black I could find, or not draw something tonight. I definitely didn't want to do that. I got my little stash. I'm gonna plug it. The camera, I'll show you. There it is. Stash of blacks I could find. If I can't finish this piece with those, then this sucker's not gonna get done. Oh, anyway. I like to tape my cord onto my tripod. I have my tripod sitting next to me, kind of right in front of me. That's why I bump it a lot. And then I tape the cord to the tripod, because inevitably I'll reach over there for something and I'll jerk my little webcam right off the head thing up here, because it doesn't really have a screw or anything. It just sits there, so it's not that good of a system. I'd really like to actually try doing try one of those GoPro cameras. I've been seeing like a lot of videos on YouTube, and a friend of mine, Sean Tiffany, he bought one a while ago, and he made I think one art video, and it was just kind of like one of those speed painting kinds where you just let the camera run, and boy, the quality on the video is just like so nice, you know. And I'm sure he let it run for a good half hour, and boy, it just looks awesome. There's no kind of lag or anything like that, and it's just super sharp. It looks like, you know, like my other videos, even though they're not high def, like the ones I was doing previously to the video blog, I did those with my point and shoot little camera. I can't remember what it is actually. It's not sitting here close. Oh no, there it is, actually, right there. It's a Lumix? Lumix? Let me grab it. Wonder if it'll do it. This is the one I used to shoot all my videos with. It's a really good camera. It's actually just a camera, but it has the, you know, the ability to shoot video. But there's Tristan. I don't know if you can see him. There he is. You can see, like, this is the problem. I don't know if you can see what's going on there. See, the stupid thing won't come out. Let me turn it back on and off. Kind of see it. See? Just not wanting to come all the way out. And so what I do is I take my knife and I pry it out. And then it would, you know, I'd work it a couple times and it would, you see, and it just says, you know, please turn the camera off again. I'd pry it out and then I'd get it working. And then I could shoot a little video. This is like when I was doing the videos that were edited. And then, you know, when I was doing the edited videos, I didn't need to shoot the whole time I was drawing. So I'd just shoot for a little bit and then turn it back off. It was kind of a pain, too, because I could only shoot, I think, 10 minutes or so on my camera. And then I had to download it, so I was always pulling the card out and downloading. And also the battery dies, like, semi-quick. So I would shoot for, like, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 times, and then I'd have to plug it back in, charge it back up. It's just past its prime. It was a good camera when I first had it, but, you know. And it's also not HD, it's just 720, I think, is all I could shoot with that one. And just, I don't know. But I've seen this, like I was saying, the videos with those GoPros, and boy, they look really good. But I think the GoPros don't actually record sound, so I think I'd have to, and this might be a reason not to get one, I'd have to, like, sync the sound, like, through a microphone or something. Which isn't a big deal. I've done that kind of stuff before, but, you know, like, you know, basically record the sound off another, or off a microphone or a different camera. So you have, like, two things running, and then when you, you know, edit it, you just put it right together. But it would be nice to have, like, a real nice, super clear picture on these. Or I think, anyway. But I don't know, I can't, I don't think the GoPros are much, but I can't really afford one right now, so this is working, so that's something to do in the future. I downloaded a program a while ago off the internet that was, I mean, it's kind of funny, like, I mean, some of you guys know, remember, like, when I was trying to do the stop motion animation, and I bought this nice camera to do it, this DSLR, where's that one at, there it is, so this is it, it's a digital SLR camera, and what is it, EOS Rebel, and it's a really nice camera. It actually has a live feed, and I needed one of these so that I could run a live feed into the stop motion program I had, so that I could have a live feed onto the camera, and then basically you just shoot pictures, and let's see if I can shoot one here. Whoops, it's busy, it's saying. Can't focus, I guess. Anyway, but I needed it for the animation. And it's like, it's funny, it's like all these cameras, you know, these DSLRs, I mean, almost all of them shoot video. And for some dang reason, I bought the one model that doesn't. So these really make, and I actually shoot, like, any kind of picture you see on my website now with these. And it kind of gives that nice, you know, depth of field kind of feel, where, you know, it's like kind of soft edges. And it's just a really nice camera. But yeah, it doesn't shoot video. And I downloaded a program I found on the net. I can't remember what that one was called. I'm not sure it really matters. But basically, it was like a program. It was kind of like a sort of a hack where you could hook your camera up to this program and shoot video off a DSLR that you basically couldn't shoot video off of. And I downloaded it, and it was like a free one. I didn't steal it or anything. And just fired it up and checked it and checked the video, and boy, it looked great and worked really well, and I was just like, awesome. And I don't know, I it was actually the video I did with the Conan one. where I did that Conan painting where he's got the sword. And that was all the footage I shot with it, and I just didn't really think anything about it. And then I got the piece done and went to edit the video, and oh man, the files, it saved the files in some weird kind of uncompressed way, so the files were like massive, you know, like every freaking just short clip that I had filmed was like, you know, 8 gigs or something. So just like editing that stuff down was like my editing program just couldn't hardly hack it. And by the time I got to the end of that video, it was just like lagging like hell, and you know, I was just like all scared I was gonna lose all the footage, and I don't know, I just kind of really like just limped my way through that video. And if you look at that video like on YouTube and stuff, it's actually really like kind of screwed up. There's like a lot of parts where the footage like stutters and all that. And I don't know if that was just because Sony Vegas couldn't hack like the size of the files. I don't know if that's true, because that's like a really good editing program, and I've never had any trouble editing stuff, even like with the stop motion animation where you're like editing actual pictures, you know what I mean, which are like a lot more whatever, data heavy than filmed footage, you know, because each frame is like a photo. And I don't know, that program just didn't work that well. Kind of worked in theory, but boy, like in practice, like once I really tried to put together a video, it was just like such a pain in the neck, so I ditched that. That was kind of when my camera was sort of starting to give me problems. But, I don't know. Those point and shoots are super cheap, though. I mean, I could pick one up for about, you know, $180 or something. And I've looked online and actually seen ones that are just like mine. You can't actually, they're all HD now. I don't even see them where they're like the same, like that 720p. And I think that camera's like about 180 or something, 170. I should probably just grab one of those and just make do with that. The microphone on the camera wasn't ever really very good, though. I wouldn't be able to shoot in the same way I'm shooting now. I'd still probably have to run my webcam. For some reason, my webcam's got like a great microphone in it. My webcam's like a Microsoft LifeCam. And it's got this like just awesome microphone, and I you know, any kind of any talking stuff that I did in any of my videos was with that, with my webcam. And it was super cheap too. I don't think it would like the life cam was, I mean, maybe $40 on Amazon when I bought it. So it's kind of cool that I did mess around with some animation, because I did figure out like a ton of stuff about video because of it, because I had, you know, I just wasn't familiar with cameras or anything like that, and other than just, you know, photography kind of stuff. And, once I started messing around with them and watched, you know, all kinds of tutorials and figured out, you know, all this stuff, it was nice. And I actually got an editing program, which before that I was always editing my videos on, like, I don't know, whatever that free one is that just comes with, you know, any kind of PC. It's like, I can't remember what it's called. Is it Windows Movie Maker or something? I think so. Which, that was a really good program for a long time. I mean, the only thing about it is it would crash. You know, I'd start loading in all my clips, and if I got out, you know, too far, the thing would start crashing. And like the way I'd kind of dealt with that is I'd just save like crazy. You know? I'd put something in and I'd save it. I'd move something around and I'd save it, you know. But, that's what I was editing like my super early videos with, which, and it worked really well. And then for some weird reason, I have no clue why, but they changed that program They went in and just, like, when I got an updated version of it, whatever, Windows or whatever, it was like I didn't even recognize the thing. And what was really screwy is it's like, I don't know if you guys even know what I'm talking about when I say an editing program, but usually with like an editing program, you have like a timeline, and it's just got a bunch of sort of lines or levels where like everything sits. So like your video will sit on one level and your audio will sit on another level, and if you want to put two pieces of film or whatever together and you know, have them fade in, you might put one shot on one level and another shot on the other level, and then kind of, you know, let it fade or something. So you end up with this big stack of all your stuff, and you just kind of move it around and play it, and, you know, move it around and just get it so that, you know, it all kind of feels right and is working. And so anyway, like when they redid that program, they changed it so that you couldn't, like, there was no way to sort of move that stuff around. You couldn't just sit there and kind of eyeball it. And it was, you like kind of had to go, okay, I'm putting in a clip, and it's like 3 seconds long or 6 seconds long. You almost kind of had to like decide that before you got it in there. And it was like, it just took out all of the, yeah, I drew a shoulder right into her hair. But it just took out all the kind of like intuitive feel, because I like to like move things a little bit and check it out and move it a little more and trim a little bit off here and trim a little there, and, you know, like when I edit stuff. And it's just like, man, you just couldn't do it anymore. So I don't know if something's going to be 2 seconds or 2.5 seconds, or, you know, I'll tell you when I get it right, and then I'll tell you how long it is. But yeah, when they did that update, I struggled with it, and I don't even think I got one video out with that new thing. I'm sure like nobody like it, you know, that cares about art is even, you know, cared about what I was talking about, because I was just gonna start talking about like all the editing programs I started messing around with. But I don't know. I went to you know, I guess I don't know. And I can't believe I forgot about this, though. I was going to talk about this right at the beginning of the video, and maybe I'll cut something in. But it's like I was on Peter Palmiotti's show, The Independent Road, yesterday, and I know I talked about it in yesterday's video, but I wanted to put it right at the beginning of the video so everybody could hear it and go click into his show, and he'd get like a bunch of hits. I appreciate him, you know, interviewing me and stuff. But it's me and this guy Kevin Cross, and we're talking about, you know, what I'm doing on YouTube and leaving my job and all that kind of stuff. So it's like, if you're one of those guys who's like trying to be an artist, or looking at me, you know, thinking, hey, this guy's doing it, maybe I could do it, go listen to that show, because there's actually a lot of good stuff in there. And I think I talk about stuff there that I probably wouldn't really maybe bring up, at least not now on my show, because I don't want to be like some like real know-it-all. But since, you know, Peter's asking me and egging me on, then I kind of talk about some stuff that, you know, I get a little bit more excited, I think, and revved up. And Kevin, I heard his bit when I listened to the show the next day, and he's all about, you know, he's just raining fire and brimstone on the whole illustration, whatever, illustration business, I guess. So that's pretty fun to listen to. So it's kind of a drag, but, I mean, it's a drag in the sense that, you know, I mean, you dream about getting into an industry like this or something, you know, or I did when I was a kid, you know. And then you get here and it's getting like all screwed up or something, you know. I heard some stuff about like the VFX, you know, business. And the same kind of thing. I don't know if any of you guys kind of caught any of that. But the guys who did the visual effects for a movie called, is it called Life of Pan? Is that what it's called? It's the one where the kid's on the boat with the tiger. Life of Pi, I think, is actually what it's called. And it's really, like, awesome effects. You know, like, a couple episodes ago, I was kind of complaining about visual effects, but I don't know. I'm not against them, and I like them when they're done good. So, and I think, like, the effects in this movie are awesome, you know. They fit the movie perfectly. But anyway, the company that did the effects on that movie won an Academy Award for their effects work. And that same year, they basically went out of business after being in, like, business for, like, you know, 30 years or something. I mean, it was, like, this long time they were around, and, you know, everybody knew them, and it was, like, there's, like, a big, long thing on YouTube about it. And at the Academy Awards, they were actually trying to kind of say, you know, at the end of the, or whatever, when they went up and got the statue or whatever, they were kind of trying to say, you know, it's just, it's kind of a drag, we're going out of business, you know, and all that kind of stuff, and say their farewells, like, up on stage. And you know how they have, like, the thing where they try to limit everybody's time up there. And I'm sure since they're not, like, you know, Brad Pitt or something, and they're just, like, you know, special effects, it's like, who cares about them, right? They basically just, like, fired the band up and cut them off in mid-sentence. And they didn't, you know, they didn't get to say their bit, and it kind of lit this firestorm in the industry about how, you know, what a shitty business visual effects is, because it's like they're all freelance, and they're all kind of, you know, bidding jobs, and, you know, a lot like illustration in a way. There's just a ton of people trying to work in that space, that want to work in that space so badly that they'll do it for nothing. And, you know, the movies and, you know, just like the comic book companies or book companies and stuff like that, a lot of them just, you know, they're a business too, and they, you know, somebody's going to come to them, you know, with a cheaper price and things like that, and it's all freelance, you know, and that's a situation you're working for yourself. So it's great when you got a job, and it ain't so great when you don't have a job. And I don't know, but that's a lot what Kevin, his name's Kevin Cross, he's doing a video called 100 Days of Making Comics, in case I didn't mention that. And they're really good, and so that's why Peter was talking to him. But anyway, that's the kind of troubles I think Kevin's kind of having with illustration. I think he's perfectly successful, but he just, you know, he wants to do comics, and he's, you know, pissed that he can't or doesn't have time to, and he's not happy with his work, you know what I mean? But his work fills up his time, so. But anyway, if you listen to the podcast, you get more of an idea what he's talking about, but it's just a really good show, and I enjoyed the heck out of it. And I love talking to Peter, too. He's, like, such a character. And, I mean, I don't know if you recognize his last name, Palmiotti, but his brother is Jimmy Palmiotti, who's a famous comic book dude. And it's funny. It's like, I know the guy's name, but it, you know, like, when I first met Peter, I definitely knew of Jimmy Palmiotti, but it's like, I don't follow comics enough to know really even what his work is, you know. But anyway, Peter was like an anchor for years and stuff. Back kind of when I was working in comics back in the 90s. Yeah, heydays of Image and Valiant and Defiant and all of other companies. Well, yeah, I was talking about editing before I got off on that. But anyway, like, after all my troubles with Windows Movie Maker, I went to doing stuff in Premiere, which is a pretty good program, but You know, it's like in Premiere, it's just like a strictly editing program, so you can't really do any kind of effects and stuff. So when I started kind of messing around with the animation, I wanted to kind of remove green screen and all that kind of stuff. And you need After Effects with Premiere to make it work right. And at that time, I didn't have After Effects. So I ended up finding this program called Sony Vegas, and it's kind of a lower end compared to After Effects. It's not as good as After Effects by any means, but it does a lot of good stuff, and it's a great editing program. And it does have some effects that you can put in, and it can handle compositing, it can handle like rotoscoping, things like that. So it's actually a really great editing program for doing like YouTube videos like I do. So that's how I ended up with that one, just in case anybody wanted to know. I haven't really talked about the piece I'm drawing either. Obviously, Johnny Weissmuller from Tarzan. And it's another one of these ones where I just kind of saw this piece of reference. I've been kind of thinking I wanted to do a Tarzan piece for a while. I've just been grabbing reference whenever I see it. And then I pulled it out. I was going to draw it last night, and I just was too darn tired. So I went to bed. I'm actually kind of tired today too, but this is like the part of like my, I don't know, whole new thing, whole new business venture that's really working, which is like these drawings I've been doing every night. Not that the rest of it isn't working, but I've had some kind of time problems with some of the stuff I've had to do during the day. But it's like I've really just been like just enjoying the heck out of doing a drawing every night and posting it up. I mean, it's just the best thing in the world. And I noticed like last night when I didn't have time to do it, I just really missed the heck out of it, you know. I had to look over at the screen just now. Some reason I just like when I'll be doing these, I'll get all paranoid. All of a sudden, I'll be like, "Oh wait, did I push the camera button?" But I did. And I don't know, like, if I told you guys too. Just as long as we're all these things are popping back in my mind, the stuff I want to talk about. What I was gonna say, that General Ursus piece I did. Did I tell you guys? I don't remember if I talked about that going to a gallery. But it's going to this Creature Features gallery in Burbank. And I might have talked about that yesterday. But anyway, I'm going to be in a show that starts next weekend and runs through till July 27th. And so it's going to be there for quite a while. I don't know if anybody lives in California, but it sounds like a pretty cool show. There's actually some big name guys going to be at it. I know William Stout's going to have work in it. Like Randy Martinez, this other guy Chris Mason, who I know on Facebook's going to have stuff in it. But it's really cool, and I just got in late. They let me in still though, and said, you know, go ahead and ship it. And I had to go run get a frame this morning and did a quick mat cut, and I kind of want to leave this loose. I'm kind of just throwing some extra loopy type stuff in here. I don't really want to stick my usual square around this thing for some reason. Yeah, they let me in the show, and my stuff's going to be hanging down there. At least that one piece. Kind of wish I would have known about it sooner. I probably would have submitted a bunch more. And I've been thinking, it's like, now I've done, you know, General Ursus, and I also did Cornelius and Zira. It's almost just screaming for me to do a Dr. Zaius, don't you think? I don't know. And then I saw the commercial for the new Planet of the Apes, and I wonder if that's why that piece sold so quick on eBay. So I didn't realize they actually had a new sequel coming out, but looks pretty cool. I think I'm gonna have to go rent that one, and maybe if I like the first one, go see the other one, maybe at the theater. I don't know. I never have time to go see a movie at the theater, but maybe see it on Redbox or something. So it looks like they got the apes riding horses now and stuff, and yeah, it could be good. Who knows? I still like the old design of the Planet of the Apes, though. To me, like, that's the Planet of the Apes. I remember seeing, like, the making of, like, episode 2 or something, where they were talking about the CG Yoda, who I really had a pet peeve against in the first couple Star Wars or whatever. Not the first ones, but, you know, the new first ones. Not that I'm a new first one Star Wars hater, but I really didn't like Yoda in that first one. I just thought, man, they made him too, like, he just looked all CG fakey, you know. And just ticked me off, you know. I was like, because I'm like a big fan of like that whole Jim Henson era puppets, and I love, like, you know, Dark Crystal and Labyrinth and just like all of those kinds of monster type things that he did outside of the Muppets, you know. There's like a TV show called The Storyteller, which is really good. If you ever get a chance to look that up, I'm sure it's on YouTube somewhere or someplace. And, you know, they just did all these creatures and did these kind of fairy tale type stories, and there's like a guide, a storyteller that tells the stories, and just like the greatest TV show. And they, I don't even think it like lasted a season, and I'm not even sure if they showed all of them on TV, because I didn't see some of them until later, until the internet came along and I went hunting for them. But but anyway, so it's like, then you got the CG Yoda that I'm getting ready to complain about, and I was like watching the making of Star Wars, which is kind of a funny one if you ever get a chance to watch like the making of the second Star Wars movie or whatever, like the of the new ones, you know, with Padme and everybody. There's like this part in there where it's like George Lucas is going to, you know, whatever, ILM, and he loses his keys, and he's like climbing the fence to get into like into the studio or whatever, and like security's all hassling him. But there's like this, you know, like what I'm talking about with Yoda is, you know, it's like it. There's in the part of the making of thing, he talks about how everybody hated the new Yoda and they all wanted the old one. And I guess he intended to actually do the puppet for the movie, like bring back the puppet version of Yoda for the second movie. And it's like, you know, in the making of, it's kind of like, well, you know how they kind of, even a documentary kind of tells a story, so it's sort of like telling the story of the VFX guys basically going, no, you know, we can't have like a, you know, they just took it as like this personal challenge that they had to make Yoda like so great, you know, that he just couldn't say no to the VFX Yoda, because the puppet just wouldn't be good enough for him, you know. And I was just like, oh man, you guys aren't true Star Wars fans. I'm interested to see what they're going to do with the new Star Wars. I mean, I have been kind of geeking out a little bit on some of the production stuff they've been showing. I saw the picture of, like, the script meeting or something, and then Harrison Ford was in there, and Carrie Fisher, Mark Hamill, and, you know, they, just, like, all the people, the new actors that are going to be in the movie, and, I don't know, I'm getting kind of jazzed for it. I remember, like, you know, before the first, you know, one came out, you know, in whatever, 2000. Was it just 2000? It might have been around there. Oh, that's a long time ago. That's like 15 years ago already. That is crazy. It's like that long ago. But, you know, like, me and my friends were just, like, just so into, like, seeing what was going to happen with that movie. And I was just super disappointed with that first one. But, kind of like the second one. I don't know if I liked it, but I didn't hate it. And then, like, for some reason, like, I saw the third one. I didn't even go see the third one at the theaters, but I saw the third one, and it's just like, once I started, like, tying it into, like, the old, you know, the old ones from the 70s, I just really liked that one for some reason. I was like, whoa, it made me want to go back and watch the other two with kind of new eyes and give them a little bit more of a chance, you know. But I still didn't like the first one, and I think that, like, that Jar Jar Binks or whatever just wrecked the whole damn thing. I just wish they wouldn't have put him in there. I just think he's, like, the worst part of that movie. And I also didn't like it the way they kind of made the Force, like, you know, the midi-chlorians or whatever the hell they were. And to me, like, you know, they almost made, like, the Force, like, a kind of, like, this religion in the first ones, to me, I thought, you know. Or it was, like, maybe not a religion, but it's, like, this kind of all-powerful spiritual thing, and then it's, like, to just explain it away with, you know, well, you got extra bugs in your veins or whatever, in your blood, and that makes you have more Force. It just was like, man, that sucked. So, I didn't like that part of it. And I also, you know, it's funny because Tristan is, like, a Star Wars fanatic. I don't know why, and I didn't push it on him, but he loves the Star Wars movies. And we only have, what do we got? We got the first one, or the 70s one, you know. The first one is, in my opinion, the one from the 70s. But basically episode 4, I guess, with Luke, you know. We got that one, we got Empire Strikes Back, and we got the second one of the new ones, where, like, Anakin has grown up into, you know, that kid, and that one's not so bad. They kind of got the, you know, they go into the arena and fight those monsters, which to me is, like, I think it's kind of a little bit of a, I don't know, tip of the hat to, like, John Carter. I kind of like that about it. And I know that John Carter was an inspiration to Lucas when he was writing the Star Wars and originally. I know Flash Gordon was also. There's a lot of similarities there. Yeah. So. But anyway, when I watch, like, that, the second of the new ones with Padme or whatever, with Anakin, I notice, like, the thing I don't like about it, because, like, now I'm watching them all the time because Tristan's always wanting to put them in. But it's like, you know, when you look at the ships, you know, like in Empire Strikes Back when the Imperial Walkers are coming in. Like, that's, like, a great example. And they're all, like, kind of tubes and, you know, like, you look at the inside of the TIE Fighters, they're, like, they're super memorable designs, in my opinion. And they look like they're just, like, you know, I don't know, what am I saying? They look like they could be real, I guess. And that ship that, like, Padme comes cruising in on in that second Star Wars. Not to start hating on Star Wars, but, like, it's like that silver thing. It doesn't even look like it really fits in the Star Wars universe, you know? It's all super reflective and slick. And then, like, in the end of, when Dooku, like, gets away. And the only thing I like about that dang movie is, when Yoda gets the lightsaber out and starts going to town. But when Dooku, like, gets away and he gets in that kind of, that other ship, and it kind of, like, opens up these big, like, solar sails or something. It's like, yeah, that's, like, a cool design, but, I mean, it's, like, it's nothing like, it doesn't look anything like the ship designs from the original Star Wars, you know? And I've read things where they're like, oh, well, it's like, supposed to be a different time, and, like, you know, the you know, things have kind of went backwards, and they're like more, you know, like the empires. You know, like, once the Empire kind of takes over, like, things go into decline, so, like, you know, that's how you end up with, like, the Millennial Falcon, like, you know, always, like, not working when it needs to and stuff like that, but I kind of think that's just, like, a cop-out. I think they just wanted to design what they wanted to design, and they didn't really think about, you know, the way the original looked or whatever. I mean, there's nothing as cool as the Imperial Walkers in the... I don't know, like the first, you know, whatever, the first of the new Star Wars, in my opinion. Like the pod racers and stuff, that was semi-cool, but it's like, come on, man. Giant freaking dinosaurs walking across the snow. That is freaking awesome, you know. So, I don't know how I got off bitching about that. Oh, because the new ones are coming out. And I really kind of wonder what's going to happen, what they're going to do. I mean, I definitely like the new Star Trek movies, but I also kind of... I mean, one thing about the Star Trek movies that I mean, I like them. I think they're great. I think the guy did an awesome job with them. But it's also... I kind of look at them like they're just sort of like one giant action sequence. You know what I mean? I don't think they have, like, what the... Like, I'm, like, a huge, like, Next Generation fan. I mean, I love those, the TV show, because of the writing. Because it's, like, super clever writing, you know what I mean? There's just, like, that show was such a great show to watch, just because it wasn't like anything else on TV, you know? And, I just so dug that. And I kind of wish that maybe, like, the new Star Wars had that, or not new Star Trek. I guess I'm saying that because the same guy who directed that, I guess, is going to be directing the new Star Wars. And I kind of wish, you know, just, you know, that they had that kind of smart writing in the movies. Because it's like the one with the, where Khan comes back. I mean, I mean, it's a cool last movie. I mean, you know, but I don't think it's as good as The Wrath of Khan, you know. And I don't know, it's like one giant fucking chase scene from, you know, from the Klingon Empire straight to Earth and right down to, like, you know, when they crash the ships, you know, it's, I don't know. And then that's one other thing, is like when they're fighting out there, you know, like, because they, when they catch up to the ship, in case you haven't seen it, I don't know, hopefully I won't spoil anything, but... You know, when RoboCop catches up to the ship there and is getting ready to blow the hell out of, you know, the Enterprise, and has him sitting there as a sitting duck, and then his daughter turns out to be on the ship. It's like you think that that's happening, like, for some reason it just seems like it's happening, like, way the hell out in space. But then, you know, like, from, like, that moment to the point where, like, Khan, you know, takes over the ship or whatever, and is, like, basically crashing it into Earth. I mean, it basically just fell out of space into Earth. So, like, didn't anybody on the Earth, like, notice that, like, there was, like, two, you know, warships sitting, like, you know, in orbit around Earth, like, getting ready to blow each other up? I mean, it just seemed like, how did that work? But now I'm complaining. I'm sure nobody else even noticed that. That was the only thing I thought about it, where I was kind of like, that doesn't make much sense. But I still like that movie. It's just like a fun movie to watch, you know. I like the guy who played Khan. Ricardo Montalban. That was like what the name I was trying to think of when I was talking about Planet of the Apes. This one's probably totally boring to everybody who's like sitting there waiting for me to hit you with some art wisdom. But I don't know. Sometimes I'm just not thinking about art. And, I think I was actually talking a little bit about just how much fun I've been having with just doing these drawings. And I really don't. It's just like, if I can't get one done, or get to one, you know what I mean? Not like I can't get one done, because there's been ones where it's kind of, haven't really had time to do the entire thing before I go to bed, but if I can't really sit down and draw these things, it's like I really just miss it, you know. For some reason I just love drawing them. I think it's just because, like, it's kind of quick, it's, you know, it takes a piece from beginning to end, and I don't know, I've always really felt more comfortable drawing than painting for some reason. I didn't really even take up painting until I was about, I might have been 30. I mean, I'd done a couple paintings in high school, but I really was just like doing the pen and ink stuff up until that point. And I don't know. I guess I just cut this one off now. I hope you guys enjoyed that. I hope I wasn't just a bunch of meaningless stuff. Maybe I should have had a little bit of a plan on this one. I don't know. But it's always tomorrow, right? So I'll see you guys tomorrow. Where's the camera shooting down here? Oh. Hey guys, it's me and Tristan, and just wanted to show you. I'm talking to the camera. Say hey everybody.
Hey.
Anyway, I want to show you the Planet of the Apes piece framed. I'm ready to go to Creature Features Gallery, Burbank. So, anyway, I'll be back. That's all.